So if you recollect, I was discussing the investment function in the context of the Keynesian economics, and what I have discussed so far is what is the difference between investment and capital, what is the difference between gross and net investment. Then I discussed what are the types of investment, and then I discussed how investment is determined by MEC, marginal efficiency of capital, in conjunction with the rate of interest. Then I showed how MEC is derived. So just to recapitulate the last point, what Keynes says is that investment is determined by marginal efficiency of capital in conjunction with the rate of interest. It is just not the rate of interest which matters, it is the comparison between MEC and rate of interest that determines the amount of investment in economy could undertake in any particular time period. So, and then when it comes to deriving MEC, what you understood is that MEC is a discount rate by itself, which equalizes the present value of the prospective yield with the supply price or the initial amount of capital invested, which is nothing but C naught being equal to summation capital RT upon 1 plus E whole to the power T, where E is the prospect, E is the marginal efficiency of capital. We have already estimated what is initial amount of capital to be invested in a new project. We have already estimated how much would be the prospective yields annually to be accruing to the firm. Then what you do not know is MEC by equalizing C naught with cap, this expression on the right side, we determine the value of E, which is MEC. Once value of E is determined, then our next job is to compare this annual rate of return over cost, which is called MEC, with the annual cost of raising capital, which could be the interest rate. So if E is greater than R, the project is profitable. If E is less than R, the project is not profitable. So we'll undertake the investment only when E is greater than R. There is another way to represent this formulation or to explain the Keynesian proposition with respect to investment decisions. What Keynes says is that he uses two different terms in the context of the derivation of MEC and the decisions to invest. One is demand price, the other one is supply price. So I talked about supply price, but then what is this supply price? According to Keynes, supply price is nothing but the sum of the prospective yields discounted at MEC. That means if you look at this particular formulation, C naught being equal to summation capital RT upon 1 plus E whole to the power T. So here C naught is the supply price. So this supply price is discounted prospective yield. So this supply price is equal to summation RT. So RT here is the prospective yield, which is discounted by the marginal efficiency of capital. Whereas when it comes to demand price, if you replace the supply price by the demand price to find out what is demand price, it is the sum of the prospective yields discounted at the current market rate of interest. That means if I replace this E by small r in the denominator, then all that I'll get will become the demand price. What I am presenting here in this equation is supply price. Supply price is equal to discounted prospective yield at marginal efficiency of capital. Demand price is the discounted prospective yield at market rate of interest. So when the market rate of interest will increase, demand price will, rate of interest will decrease, demand price will increase, and vice versa. So the, as I have already said, if E is greater than R, new investment will be profitable. If MEC is greater than rate of interest, new investment is profitable, which implies that MEC should be MEC would be greater than R, or the demand price will be greater than supply price only when rate of interest is lower than the marginal efficiency of capital. So if you know demand price, you know the supply price, the decision rule is demand price should be greater than the supply price. And demand price is derived by using bank interest rate or the cost of raising capital as the discount rate, whereas supply price is derived by using MEC as the discount rate. And then you compare supply price to the demand price. So if demand price is greater than the supply price, which implies MEC is greater than the rate of interest, the project is profitable, project will be undertaken, more investment will be possible, otherwise not. So this is what is Keynesian proposition all about when it comes to determining investment, which is contrary to what classical economists have said. Classical economists have said that more investment is possible in an economy if rate of interest decreases. You charge low rate of interest on the loans, then, or when the company is raising capital from the market, if the cost of raising that capital is low, more investment is possible. So, according to classical economists, the solution to low investment is, or to attract more investment, what is required is you reduce the rate of interest. Banks must charge lower rate of interest if you like to attract more investment in the economy. But Keynes says the rate of interest alone is not sufficient. What is important is, given the rate of interest, unless MEC is greater than the rate of interest, the investors should not come forward to invest. Hence, both MEC and rate of interest matter, not just the rate of interest. But then MEC and rate of interest must also be determined before the investment is carried out. We need to know how much is the rate of interest to prevail and what is the MEC before investment decisions are taken. But then when it comes to determining MEC and rate of interest, they were their own sets of factors to determine them. Rate of interest is determined by its own set of factors. There are again different models. One particular argument is that rate of interest is determined when saving becomes equal to investment. That is classical approach. But Keynes says rate of interest is determined when money demand becomes equal to money supply. So I am not getting into that debate here. I will only stick to the MEC part. So MEC is not determined by rate of interest. MEC has its own set of factors to determine it. Similarly, rate of interest is not determined by MEC. It has its own set of factors to determine. So I shall talk about the MEC, how it is determined, or it is to be determined before investment is determined. But before that, before I discuss what determines MEC, let me present to you some other issues related to the derivation of MEC and the investment decisions. Now, given the fact that MEC is the highest rate of return over cost on the capital invested, we can derive the MEC schedule. And what is that MEC schedule represent? What does it represent? It represents the rate, the highest rate of return on each additional amount of capital invested. So MEC schedule or MEC curve, which I have drawn here, is negatively sloped, which shows or which implies that MEC falls when there is rise in investment. And this could happen because of the diminishing marginal productivity of capital. As more and more amount of capital is invested, it is likely that the successive amount of capital investment would give lesser and lesser return. So marginal productivity of capital keeps decreasing, and that gets reflected in the derivation of MEC. So marginal efficiency of capital decreases with the rise in the amount of investment. When you show the MEC schedule, the issue here is, why does the marginal productivity of capital decreases, or why MEC schedule is negatively sloped? This is because initial investments are concentrated on the best opportunities, and later investments are less productive, and they obviously secure progressively lower returns. Or to put it otherwise, when it comes to a company, suppose I talk about a single company, how would a company choose various projects, investment projects? A company has, suppose, 5 projects in hand, A, B, C, D, E, 5 projects in hand. All have been evaluated before they are implemented. And the company has estimated the marginal efficiency of capital of each project. So when it comes to company choosing which project to undertake first, what the company would do, obviously, it would choose the best project, and that best project is decided on the basis of the highest return. So the company would choose that project first, which has the highest marginal efficiency of capital. Suppose project A has 15% return, 15% MEC. MEC value is estimated to be 15%. Project B has 13% of MEC. Project C has 11% of MEC. Project D has 9% of MEC. Project E has 8% of MEC, like this. So what I am talking about, 5 projects, A, B, C, D, E. So what the company should do? The company would arrange the projects in the decreasing orders of their, in the decreasing order of their rate of return. The first project would be selected. That project would be selected first, which has the highest rate of return, then the second, then the third, then the fourth, in the decreasing order of the MEC. So that is the reason why the MEC schedule I am talking about would show a negative slope, implying thereby higher the amount of investment you are making, lower is the MEC you can experience. Now the question is, where does the investor stop? How much of investment the investor should do, given the fact that MEC schedule is negatively sloped? Higher the amount of investment, lower is MEC. So given the fact that this kind of a scenario prevails, how much of investment an investor will make in a particular time period? So if MEC schedule is MEC 1 and rate of interest is 20%, then the maximum amount of investment the company can make is I naught amount, it will not go beyond I naught, which implies that when you know that MEC schedule is negatively sloped, as more and more amount of investment is made, the MEC keeps decreasing, the company will continue to make investment as long as or until MEC becomes equal to the rate of interest. Any project, or if rate of interest is higher than MEC, the investment will not be carried out. So the company, or for that sense, the entire economy will continue to make investment until marginal efficiency of capital becomes equal to the rate of interest. So suppose rate of interest is 20%, then how much of investment you can expect in an economy? It would be, suppose, I naught. If rate of interest decreases, then amount of investment could increase from I naught to I one. So what it shows, that it is not that we can only say MEC is important. As you can observe here, given the MEC schedule, it is the decrease in the rate of interest which leads to increase in the amount of investment. So we cannot ignore the role of MEC, it's the rate of interest, completely. Though Keynes says that MEC is more important than rate of interest, because this free fall of rate of interest may not be something that you may always experience. And moreover, I'll talk about some other issues as I proceed to the topic later on. So, and what Keynes says basically is that whether, see, it is true that when MEC, when rate of interest decreases, investment will rise. But imagine a situation where the rate of interest decreases by 5%, investment increases by 1%. Let me repeat, rate of interest decreases by 5%, investment increases by 1%. This is one case. Second one is, rate of interest decreases by 2%. Investment increases by 8%. Now look at these two cases. In one case, investment is highly sensitive to the rate of interest. In the other case, investment is less sensitive to the rate of interest, which otherwise implies that investment demand schedule would be steeper in one case, would be flatter in the other case. Investment demand would be more elastic with respect to rate of interest in one case, and it could be less elastic in the other case. So if by reducing rate of interest by 5%, a significant fall, you realize only 1% rise in investment, then investment is less elastic. Investment demand is less elastic to rate of interest. But if a slight fall in the rate of interest, only by 2% fall in the rate of interest, or even 1% fall in rate of interest, there is increase in investment by 7% or 8%. Then it is something, it shows that investment is highly sensitive to rate of interest. What Keynes says is that in the real world situation, investment is less sensitive to rate of interest. So the investment demand schedule I'm talking about is steeper, it is not flatter. That means investment demand doesn't increase more than proportionately with the decrease in the rate of interest. It increases less than proportionately with the decrease in the rate of interest. So, even if we find that whenever there is decrease in the rate of interest, there will be increase in investment. How much increase you experience is important. You decrease the rate of interest from 20% to 10% by 10%. Is the increase in investment, you know, more than proportionate? That means a fall is by 10%. Is the rise in investment more than 10%? Or it is less than 10%? If it is less than 10%, that is Keynesian. Keynes says that investment is not very responsive to rate of interest. It doesn't increase more than proportionately with the decrease in the rate of interest. So even if rate of interest is a very important factor, is an important factor, it is not as important as MEC is. So on the left side of the diagram, as you observe, if there is only one MEC schedule, then it shows if the rate of interest is 20%, the investors will invest up to I naught amount. If investment decreases to 10%, the investment will increase to I1 amount. So, as I said, the investors will keep investing until MEC becomes equal to the rate of interest. So, if the rate of interest decreases, more MEC, more investment would be possible. Look at the right side diagram. If for some reason MEC schedule will shift towards the right, and what does a rightward shift in the MEC curve represent? It shows higher MEC corresponding to each amount of investment you carry out, regardless of the rate of interest. If MEC schedule shifts towards right, which could happen because of technological progress or any other factor. I mean, you are assuming that 15% would be the highest return from the project, rate of return from the project. But suppose you can increase the rate of return or the MEC of that project from 15% to 20%, which could happen because of certain factors, then MEC will shift. So if MEC shifts towards right, because of several factors, then even if rate of interest remains unchanged at 20, you can still have greater amount of investment to happen. Not I naught amount as I showed in the previous instance. It can be I2 amount, which is shown on MEC2 schedule. So even at the same higher rate of interest of 20%, more investment is possible if there is shift of the MEC schedule, which could happen because of various factors, which I'll discuss now. So what you see here is that according to Keynes, investment is determined by MEC in conjunction with the rate of interest. But as it appears, between the two, MEC is more important, because as you observed in the right side of the diagram, even if rate of interest remains high, if MEC schedule can go rightward, it can shift, we can keep realizing higher and higher amount of investment. So the question here is, then how can we increase MEC, or what determines or what influences the marginal efficiency of capital? Remember, marginal efficiency of capital is not same across the countries. You make same amount of investment in India as you like to make in China or in Vietnam or in Singapore. You may not get the same rate of return from different countries. The MEC may not become same in different countries. Similarly, in different time periods, you might realize different rates of return in different countries. The question is, why does MEC vary? Not only that, MEC could vary across countries. MEC could also vary within a country across states. Like suppose I am talking about India. The MEC, the rate of return over cost, could vary within a country across states. The MEC derived from investment in Tamil Nadu could be different from the MEC that you derive from a state like West Bengal or Odisha. So how is this, why does the MEC vary? What determines this MEC value? Across states, across countries, across different kinds of projects, across different kinds of business you are doing. MEC again is not same across all kinds of business. Why does MEC vary? Now, when you talk about MEC, remember one thing, that the entire topic that I am discussing is basically dealing with the decision to invest, not the actual investment. The company is planning to invest, is contemplating to invest. So before it invests, it estimates how much would be the MEC from a new project. Once the MEC is estimated to be higher than the cost of raising capital, the company will undertake the investment, otherwise it will not. So what is the guiding spirit, underlying factor behind this MEC, derivation of the MEC value? It is the expectations, which can be short term and long term. The companies can build expectations around the business in a particular country, in a particular state, for the short run and also for the long run. Expectations about profit, expectations about the business environment, expectations about the government policies, expectations about the returns that they would like to get from the business in the future once they invest. So when they build a positive expectations about the business, they invest. If they build negative expectations, they don't invest. And these expectations can be short term, can be long term. That means the business is guided by both short term and long term expectations. The short term expectations are about certain goals which are to be met, certain happenings in the economy which could affect your decisions. Long-term expectations are more fundamental in nature. If you are going to do the business in the long run, then you would be guided more by long-term expectations than the short-term expectations, though you cannot ignore the short-term expectations as well. As I proceed to discuss different factors which matter in building short-term and long-term expectations, you will get to understand what are they. How does a firm or a company, or how does an economy build up expectations, positive expectations about business, about investment in an economy or within an economy across states, suppose, across different regions? It could depend upon several factors. It could be infrastructure, governance, capital equipment supply, and so on. As you can see, I have given a list of 8 such factors which could determine the levels of expectations. And finally, MEC, marginal efficiency of capital. Among all, and this list is simply indicative. Let me clarify, that this list is simply indicative, not exhaustive. There could be many other factors. I'm only bringing in a debate here just to let you know how MEC is determined. It doesn't mean that I'm talking about all the factors that determines MEC, that determine MEC. Among all the factors that I talk about, the most important one is the infrastructure facilities. Better the infrastructure, more the amount of infrastructure you have created in an economy, greater is the possibility of MEC, higher MEC, and greater would be the amount of investment an economy can undertake in any particular time period. So what is infrastructure? Infrastructure is all about socio-economic overhead capital that you create in an economy, which comprise roads, electricity, irrigation, hospitals, educational institutions, airports, ports, railway networks. All these are examples of infrastructure, physical infrastructure you create in an economy. So why do we need infrastructure of these kinds? Why do we need roads? Why do we need airports? Why do we need the ports and so on? Because they improve the productive capacity of an economy. Infrastructure improves the productive capacity of any kind of economic activity you carry out. Better roads guarantee greater productivity because you save your time, money and energy because of a better road. If you have a better road to travel from here to Kolkata, then you save your money, you save your time, you save your energy. And it applies more to the business. If you look at Indian economy across states, some states are more industrialized compared to others. Gujarat, Tamil Nadu are more industrialized compared to, suppose, Bihar, Odisha, and so on. Why some states are more industrialized compared to others? One of the basic reasons is the variations in infrastructure facilities. Some states are endowed with better quality and more amount of infrastructure compared to others. So, and today we're talking about this. If you have come across the budget of this particular year, which was presented this month by our finance minister, we have given a lot of emphasis to infrastructure building, particularly the road infrastructure. You know that that we are trying to connect all the cities, all the areas across the country through better roads. So, and why do we need it? Because it improves the productive capacity of the economy. It improves the quality of life of the people. And so infrastructure is the most important thing, prerequisite, without which you cannot expect the investment to happen. So when it comes to infrastructure facilities, we are far behind China. And that could be one of the reasons why China attracts more FDI, foreign direct investment, compared to India. More domestic investment compared to India. Second one is governance. It is all about the law and order. It is all about the kinds of the governance measures you undertake to facilitate the business environment or the business world. The governance measures are not uniform across all the states in our country, or governance measures are not uniform across the globe. If I talk about one typical governance measure, these days we are talking about e-governance. So the e-governance is all about, you know, paperless transaction. You know, this year we presented the budget, which is paperless. okay, for a different reason, because it is a pandemic time, so we decided not to use papers. But then e-governance is something which is required to facilitate the business, to not only business, even all kinds of activities are to be carried out through e-governance measures, so that the things become smoothened. Be it digitization of the economy, digitization of banks, be it even digitization of issuing the registration or license. If you like to get a driving license, if it is digitized, today I was reading a news that Odisha government has introduced e-governance measures under for the RTO, that which issues registration for your vehicles, registration, driving license and all that for the vehicles, for the drivers. So it has introduced e-governance measures, possibly the fastest to completely make it as a e-governance measure. So these are certain forward-looking measures that you undertake to attract investment in an economy. Similarly, the other part which is equally important is the law and order. Maintaining law and order, providing better quality is a very important attribute of better quality governance. So that is very important for any economy, or be it the entire country I am talking about, or it's about a particular state within the economy. Third one is capital equipment supply. You know that when it comes to doing the business in a country like India, any capital equipment you are making use of in course of undertaking the business, till the other day, or even now also, we import a significant portion of that from abroad. The capital equipment which is in use, a machine, a plant which you are going to install, how much of that plant, or is this plant built within the country with our own technology, or it is imported from abroad? Today we are talking about make in India. It is all about allowing or promoting or asking the companies to come to India and start, because of this kind of scenario, with this kind of provision. So capital equipment supply can be possible within the country. You can develop the machine. You can develop the technology only when you invest in R&D. In a country like India, as you know, there is very insignificant portion of a company's profit is directed towards, or compared company's total investment is directed towards hardly any company in India bring capital from abroad or from others than creating the capital by themselves by technology. So developing technology involves R&D investment, which the companies are not prepared for. But that doesn't really attract more investment to an economy. So any economy of the world you talk about, which has been able to make more R&D investment, has attracted more investment, be it domestic and foreign. Both foreign direct investment and domestic investment have been higher in those economies where R&D investment or R&D expenditure has been higher. So this is another factor that matters to the investors. Next one is the change in income, the income itself. So I'll talk about this factor and the business cycle, the last point, together. Whether how much would be the MEC you can expect from the business will depend upon what is the stage of the business cycle, the phase of the business cycle you're experiencing. An economy experiences or operates in a business cycle. Sometimes it experiences boom, some other times it experiences recession. During times of boom, the income growth is positive, and subsequent growth rates are higher than the previous growth rates. Whereas in times of recession, the growth rate of income GDP is negative. So when the economy experiencing negative growth rate of GDP, which implies that it is recession, or it could be entering into recession, obviously that economy will not attract more investment, because this is there is already a huge amount of overproduction in this particular economy. The companies which have already been into the business, they are already incurring huge losses because all that they have produced have not been sold. So in that kind of an economy, you cannot attract more investment, new investment. So it is the change in income that means whether you experience a positive change in income or negative change in income. What pace of growth of income? 2%, 3% of income in a country like India is not. Our growth rate should be 7%, 8%, or even more than that. Whereas maybe in China, but if you take the case of USA, even 2-3% of growth rate could be enough, because that base is very high. Our base is low. Our total GDP is only $3 trillion, about $3 trillion. So we need to grow at a faster rate. Not 3% would be enough. We cannot compare ourselves with USA to tell that if they are growing at 3% and if we are growing at 3%, we are same. We are in the same boat. No, because our base is much lower than theirs. So they are 6 times larger than us, 5 times larger than us, 4 times larger than us in terms of their total income. So base is very high. So an economy will attract more investment only when it has a positive income change to experience. There is prosperity you can expect, or it is already growing. It is already showing the signals of growth, positive growth. Next one is the production methods. What method of production you adopt, that could also be a deciding factor to determine the value of MEC and the amount of income that investment you can attract finally. You know that there can be two methods of production: capital intensive method of production or labor intensive method of production. As you know, Indian economy always adopts labor intensive method of production. Why? Because India has a labor surplus economy. It has huge amount of labor available, surplus labor. People in the age group of 15 to 65 are huge. So we need to employ them. So we like to adopt labor intensive method of production. But there is another reason why you also adopt labor intensive method of production. That is that labor is cheaper. Because we have a labor surplus economy, we have surplus labor available, labor is cheaper. So by adopting labor intensive method of production, we might produce, or we might to realize a higher MEC, but it may not be always so. It all depends upon the nature of the business. Where capital intensive method of production is desirable from the point of view of improved productive capacity or ensuring improved productive capacity, we adopt labor intensive method of production because you'll have to employ people, then we may not guarantee higher MAC. So it is important to understand what kind of economic activity you are carrying out, what kind of business it is, whether it is desirable to go for labor intensive or capital intensive method of production. So this is yet another factor. Next one is government policy. What kind of government policy we formulate to promote business in an economy? We keep formulating newer and newer policies, keeping in mind the demands from the business houses, corporate houses, their requirements. There are two major macroeconomic policies we talk about. One is called fiscal policy, the other one is called monetary policy. They are the two major policies we formulate in any economy of the world. Fiscal policy is what government presents or formulates, whereas monetary policy is formulated by the apex bank of the country. In our case, it is Reserve Bank of India. These two policies are very important for the investors to invest, for the economy to run in a particular way, in a particular manner. So your fiscal policy is all about tax and expenditure policies. What kind of tax policies you are introducing, what kind of expenditure policies you are introducing when it comes to government spending money. Whereas the your monetary policy is all about the measures government undertakes to increase or decrease the money supply in the economy through the commercial banks, like the retail banks you have, like SBI, PNB and all that. Through them, we try to, RBI has the power to control money supply, so it undertakes several measures which are implemented finally by the commercial banks. Then there are other policies as well, which are beyond fiscal and monetary policy. It can be some policies with respect to exim policy, for example, with respect to export and import, like to promote export and reduce import and so on. You need to have a policy and so on. There can be several other policies. You might have recently come across a policy called GST, Goods and Services Tax. It is a tax measure, a new policy which was introduced in a country like India, a uniform tax structure we adopted in the field of indirect taxes. So this kind of a policy, government policy, has promoted business in our country. So how proactive the government is when it comes to implementing policies so that investors will come forward to invest more. So that is very important for an economy to understand. So if there are certain business requirements and government is responding to that through certain measures proactively, then only the MEC can be expected to be higher and more investment would be forthcoming, otherwise not. Last but not the least is the nature of demand. As you know, over the last 20 years or so, if you look at Indian economy, one of the reasons why India has been a destination for FDI or domestic investment, whatever, is the amount of demand, increased demand for goods and services, and particularly consumption demand. India, over the last 15 to 20 years, experienced a significant rise in the consumption demand, particularly the consumer durables, be it a TV, fridge, washing machine, cars, all these are consumer durables we talk about. So the mobiles and anything we talk about, so these are different consumer durables I talk about. So there has been a huge surge in the demand for these goods, in Indian market. Why does it happen? Because India has huge working age population in the age group of 15 to 65. So we say India is into the phase of demographic dividend. It has huge working age population. It has huge middle class population whose incomes keep rising. As India's income keep rising, these people's income keep rising, keeps rising, and then they are the aspiring class. They like to meet many of their unmet demands. So that is the reason why today you see huge increase in the demand for consumer goods, and consumer goods industries are coming up in big ways, or had come up, barring exceptions, like particularly because of the pandemic, things have become different. Demand has slowed down, but otherwise there is rise in the demand for consumer goods. And that is one of the reasons why the industries like to come up here to set up their farms here, that and then do the business here itself. Today, if you see Apple coming to India, today if you see Tesla coming to India, if you see Samsung coming to India, it's all because they know there is a market waiting for them, and which they would like to exploit. So this is another reason why, I mean, what determines the MEC. Higher the demand for goods and services, particularly consumption demand I'm talking about, higher would be MEC and higher would be investment. So whichever country, whichever state within the country can guarantee these things is expected to assure higher MEC, and that would lead to higher investment. So that way, if I conclude, I would say that Keynesian economics is more logical, because it tells how investment is determined. Investment is not determined by rate of interest only, it is determined by MEC in conjunction with the rate of interest. So here I stop. So time is over.